Heavenly Father, you always amaze me. Let your kingdom come in my world and in my life. Give me the food I need to live through today. And forgive me as I forgive the people that wrong me. Lead me far from temptation. Deliver me from the evil one. I look out the window, the birds are composing. Not a note is out of tune or out of place. To the meadow and stare at the flowers, better dressed than any girl on her wedding day. So why should I worry? Why do I freak out? God knows what I need. You know
Avenue. How are you all today? I can't really hear you. How are you guys doing today? There we go. We have a fun day today as we get to celebrate two baptisms. At camp this past week, two of our students one placed their faith and trust in Jesus and is now stepping forward already. To be baptized, that'd be Anessa. And then Ms. Journey was already saved, but she had never been baptized. And so she wanted to now step out and profess her faith in Jesus and follow through in believer's baptism. So Anessa, you placed your faith and trust in Jesus on Thursday, did you? Yes. And you've made him Lord of your life? Yes. Amen. You believe that he died and rose again? Yes. Hallelujah. I'm going to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in Christ in people's baptism, raised to walk in the newness of life. And this is Miss Journey. Many of you guys know Miss Journey, her family, and I'm sure Sissy's somewhere here in the sanctuary. And God, we are so thankful that, Journey, you have been here and have been a part of our church and have really jumped into the youth ministry. And you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And you've made him Lord of your life. You believe that he died and rose again. Hallelujah. I want to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in Christ in biblical baptism, raised to walk in the newness of life. Amen and amen. Well, we're going to get continue with an amazing service. Would you guys pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for this picture of new life that we see in Journey and Anessa. Lord, they place their faith and trust in you, and Lord, they have now taken that step to let everybody else know here in church and in their family that they are believers in Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for saving our souls. We thank you, Lord, for the demonstration of this new life that you have given us that these girls have just walked through. And God, we ask that you continue to move in and through this service this day. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us stand and continue to celebrate and worship this morning.
Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this bag of bones. I try with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me Savior, because you heal my heart, you change my name, forever free, I am not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God. I cannot deny what I've seen, got no choice but to believe, my doubts are burned like ashes in the wind. So, so long to my old friend. Burden and bitterness, you can't escape and move it. You ain't welcome me. From now till I walk, from now till I walk the streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son is found his way back home. You pick me up and turn me around. You place my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you heal my heart and change my name. Forever free, I am not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, I thank God. I lost another one, and I am free. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am free. I lost another one, and I am free. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am. Sing that out.
Exchange. All right, this morning, it's a special day. We get to celebrate a little bit of what God has done for us this week. I bid you welcome from Falls Creek Youth Camp this week. You'll notice that all of our students this morning are sporting our green shirts from camp, and we had an absolutely amazing week of camp. I can't wait to share a little bit more about that a little bit later on in our worship service today. We started something a little over a month ago now, during our ministry moment called the Deacon Prayer Time. And at this time, our deacons and their wives can make their way to their stationed locations throughout the room. They're going to be stationed in a few different spots throughout our sanctuary this morning. And I'll kind of explain what this is for. This is an opportunity for you to step out and simply be prayed over this morning. Maybe you have a specific thing that is burdening your heart today. Maybe you have something going on in your life that you desperately need to cry out to God for, and you would like somebody else to cry out to the Lord with you. That is what this opportunity is for. So for the next couple of songs this morning, our deacons and Pastor John are going to be stationed at various locations throughout the room in the aisles. Feel free, as we're worshiping the Lord through song this morning, feel free to step out and simply be prayed over. Allow God to use this time for His glory as we make our requests known before Him. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to continue in song. But if that's you and you'd like to just step out and be prayed for this morning, or if you have a specific request that you want to be that you want prayed for today, just step out, find one of our nearest deacons or Pastor John, and that's what this time is for. Would you pray with me? Lord, we are grateful for your love, we're grateful for your mercy, and we thank you for all that you are doing in our midst. And today, as we celebrate that, and as we go before you in intentional prayer, Lord, we ask that you would move in a way that only you can do. That you would move in a way only you can move, and that we would recognize it, we would see it, and that we would know that it is you, and it can only be you. An unmistakable move of your Spirit. And Lord, as we sing these songs, as we often pray, Lord, may they be glorifying to you. May it be an aroma that is pleasing to your heart, O God. And as we lift these prayers up, Lord, would you fill this room with your Spirit and let us draw sinners to repentance. Would it draw sinners to repentance through your loving kindness today? We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us worship the Lord together. Step out as you need prayer this morning.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold, call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I can't.
sing that again. Why should I gain from his reward?
Why should I gain from his reward? I can't give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
Amen.
The great King of glory, seated on high in the heavens, oh Lord. Jesus, you alone. You are the Lord God Almighty, strong in compassion.
Search the world.
And I've searched the world for a love that could fill my heart. Oh, but nothing compares to the wonder of who you are. It's only all the esteem, only all
the world.
And I search the world for a love that can fill my heart. Oh, but nothing compares to the wonder of who you are. It's only all the earth
from the grave.
You rose from death with the morning. You come again in your glory. Oh, Jesus, you we
I was buried beneath my bed, lost without hope of redemption, blind in my need for saving. Oh, but God, crushed by the weight of my faith, living the lie I created, digging my grave without no hope. Oh, but God, oh, but God, sing, rich in mercy, how you love me too much to let me stay alive. Truth worth believing, and I traded my chains for your freedom, 'cause you were the one that I needed. Oh, but God, resurrecting my heart from the ruin, and my rescue came through like the morn. This is our story. Now this is my sure testimony. Oh, but God, oh, but God, rich in mercy, how you love me too much to let me stay alive. My salvation sent from heaven, nailing my sin to the cross. Oh, but trespasses, in our failings, in our struggles, you are a God who loves us, and you look upon us, and you bestow your grace and mercy upon us. And Lord, we are reminded of that daily, and we're reminded of that as we worship in spirit and in truth here today. Would you continue to move in power in this place through an unmistakable move of your spirit, O God? We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I want to dismiss our children 4 years old through third grade to a time of children's church today. You may be seated, and I invite you, as the children are headed out for children's church this morning with Miss Donna, I invite you to turn your attention to the screen as we share a few highlights from camp this week. So sit back and relax for just a minute.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, what is our only confidence? Let our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hand. What comes apart from His command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing.
The Lord spoke to me this last week was that our plans aren't necessarily what God has in mind for us, and that His plans are greater than our plans.
Gary, how has the Lord moved in your life this week? He moved in my life this week by showing me that even though I thought I knew him throughout worship and TAV, he's proven that despite the God I thought he was, he's a better God, and what I was doing wasn't very Christian-like. And he showed me that this week by showing me the ways the devil has stolen my identity and had me think about them.
So come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and
amen. Well, good morning, church family. I had the opportunity earlier to once again just bid you welcome and hello from Falls Creek Youth Camp this week. You see all of our kids up here up front today rocking their green t-shirts, and they are excited this morning. I can tell you that was a very lively Sunday school class we had today upstairs, and we started this thing while we were at camp, and I'm going to let church family let you in on it a little bit today. We started this thing while we were at camp where we would applaud random things for no reason. So everybody, random things. Yeah. I don't know why we do that, but they love it, so it's fantastic. So I invite you, in your copy of God's Word this morning, I invite you to find 2 Corinthians chapter 12 with me as we think upon today God's grace. And I throughout the week, I could not think of a better term, a better word to use to wrap up our week and to kind of recap our week. But God's grace. And his grace is sufficient. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to look just at verses 9 and 10. And I invite you, where you are, I invite you to stand in the honor of reading God's word today. I'm going to start in verse 1 of chapter 12, and then we're going to end in verse 10. And verses 9 and 10 will be where we camp out today. So find verse 1 of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and I invite you to read with me. It'll be on the screen as well. I must go on boasting. Though there is nothing to be gained by it, I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who, 14 years ago, was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. Verse 5. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast. Except of my weaknesses, though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So, to keep me from becoming conceited, because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being or becoming conceited. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for how it speaks to us. We thank you that on a day like today, we can celebrate. We can celebrate what you are doing, but Lord, we pray that you would speak directly to each heart in this place today.
As we examine your word, we pray that it would draw sinners to repentance, that it would draw the believer to be challenged to live a life that is pleasing to you. Teach us something about who you are today. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So going throughout the week this week, before we dive in further to that text, there are a few people that I just want to take this opportunity to thank. Number one, church family, that's you. We are so grateful that you give so generously, that you support so well our student ministry. Our senior adult Sunday school class did a wonderful, wonderful job. They packed these little gift bags for our students. And when the students arrive at camp, it's a great start to the week already because they get to go to their bunk and they see this little gift that's there for them. It has a few things in it, like some hygiene stuff that, you know, seventh grade boys sometimes forget. And then some other little items that, you know, are just beneficial and helpful throughout the week. Some little snacks as well. And so when they get there, they get to open this awesome little bag. So I want to thank, number one, our senior adult Sunday school class for putting that together. And then additionally, church, you guys give so well. We would not be able to take our students to camp for as cost effectively as we do if you guys were not faithful to give to that mission. And that means a lot to me, and I know it means a lot to these kids. They have a blast, and it is an amazing week, and we're just so grateful that you are faithful to give in that way. But I also want to honor our sponsors this morning as well. There are many people that attend camp with us that you guys recognize very well because they are serving often in our church. And every single one of them took a week out of their life. I tell our kids this. They took a week out of their life to hang out with a bunch of teenagers and show them Jesus. And that's pretty cool. So Jeff Huber, Pauline Warren, Crystal Viesca, Angel, Kathy, and my wife Ashley, who's in the back. Man, thank you guys for your efforts this week. It was an amazing week. And church, we have some amazing servants of the Lord in our midst. And they are faithful to serve, and they're faithful to do what the Lord has called them to do. But I say all of that to say, yes, the Lord moved in a great way this week. But at every turn, I was reminded of the abundant grace of God. That even though we don't deserve it, even though we have done absolutely nothing in our own power to earn it, we are able to receive it anyway. And we find Paul in his second letter to the church at Corinth, he's talking a lot about boasting. He's talking a lot about being conceited. And he's sharing in this letter this vision, right? He's sharing this revelation that was had. And he's talking through it, sharing mostly about the fact that in this vision, he's seeing the third heaven. He's seeing heaven. And he's, you know, seen things that man is not supposed to speak of because they're so great of the Most High God, you can't even comprehend it. But then you go down a little bit further. It says there, even though he is in his nature one who wants to boast, who wants to be conceited, who wants to share about how good he himself is, he can't help but stop short of that and boast of God instead. And so he stops short of boasting about what he has done so that he might not become conceited. And it says there, in verse 7, for some context to the passage that we're going to land on today, to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. So how can we take that? He was given a weakness so that he was reminded to be dependent on God. He was given this thorn in his side so that he would recognize that he on his own is not immortal. That he on his own has a weakness. Verse 8, it says, three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. And I think that can relate pretty quickly to many people in this room who consistently, over and over again in our life, we find ourselves in a place of weakness. We find ourselves recognizing over and over and over again that God is the only one who can handle certain things. Because even though we think we have it all together, there's a point where the ability of what we can do ends and what only God can do begins. So we see there, he pleads for the Lord that it should leave me, but then into verse 9, this is where we're going to begin today. Verse 9, it says, "But he said to me," he being the Lord, "he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you." My grace is sufficient for you. Church family, this morning, if you hear nothing else, the points that I've put together, you can put those off to the side. All you need to hear right now at this point is verse 9. It says, "My grace is sufficient for you." If you hear nothing else, take that with you today. His grace is enough in your life, no matter your weakness, no matter your circumstance, no matter what you are encountering on a day-to-day basis. And let's analyze a little bit more of this passage this morning. I encourage you not to get bogged down in, I know it talks about, you know, third heaven. It talks about paradise. Essentially, what that's referring to is the heaven that we think of. But don't get bogged down in that. Get bogged down in the fact that God's grace is enough for you today. So as we continue, I want to remind us of that. Our goal today is to recognize our need to be satisfied by our God in all situations of life. Every situation in our life, by analyzing Paul's writings in his second letter to the church at Corinth, which leads us to the first thing I want you to know. We're going to see that in four ways today. Be overwhelmed by his grace. Be overwhelmed by his grace. So even in Paul's weakness, he is actively given a weakness. I had the opportunity this past week to do a little breakout at camp that was basically a one-hour session of the Psalms. So if you have read through the Psalms, or you're getting there in our, I know we're getting there in our daily reading as well, there's a lot. 150 to be exact. So the challenge was overview of Psalms in an hour, okay? 150 Psalms, let's condense it all to 1 hour, right? But there's a few things that stuck out with me in preparation for that. Being reminded of God's grace, his grace is sufficient, and what is broken, he restores. And when we see in the Psalms, what we see in the Psalms is that in every bit of life, even when we find ourselves weak, even when we find ourselves stuck with a brokenness, and the way we phrased it earlier in the week was that you don't want to continue on. You're so broken that you don't have the ability to continue doing what you're doing, because if you did, you would become more and more distraught. And every time we see the Psalms talk about brokenness, the writer is usually coming from a place of brokenness, from a place where they're just broken beyond restoration. But God takes what is broken, what is weak, makes it whole once again. And we see that for our weakness as well. Our theme passage for the entire week of camp this week in our cabin was Titus chapter 2. We focused specifically on verses 11 through 15. And in verses 11 through 15, it says there, "For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people." Every single one of us has weakness, because every single one of us has sin. And with every one of us having weakness in our life because of that sin, we need saving. We need salvation. And God's grace brings that to us. That is an overwhelming truth to me. I hope it's an overwhelming truth to you as well. That in the midst of how broken, how battered we are, we have grace in our God. But then it says, it brings salvation to all people. And then in verse 12, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous. And we talked heavily about that word this week, who are zealous with good work, who have a passion and a zeal for doing good things for the kingdom of God. God's grace doesn't only save us, it then trains us how to live. and it shows us and teaches us how to live a life that is pleasing and honoring to the Lord. Hear that this morning, that Christ's grace is enough not only to save you, but mold you into the person that God has called you to be. It doesn't stop at salvation, although salvation is definitely the most important part, right? It doesn't stop there, it continues on. Be overwhelmed by the grace of God. It should overwhelm us to the point where we cannot help but be drawn to turn away from unrighteousness. So, simple question for you today, does God's grace draw you to flee evil? Does God's grace draw you to flee what is not right? It actively trains us and builds us toward renouncing the things of the world. So in your weakness, in your struggle, be overwhelmed by the grace of God. Do you live as though the grace of God is enough in your life? When you have these weak moments, these moments, whether it's sin or whether it's a specific challenge you face in your day-to-day life, do you live your life as though God's grace is enough? Paul was getting to the point, and I believe that God would not have done this to Paul had he not been nearing this point. Paul says that if he would have continued on without this quote-unquote thorn in his side, that he would become conceited. And we know this whole passage tells us not to be boastful in ourselves. Paul, had he not been given this weakness, would have become conceited. Paul, the same Paul in the book of Acts who is standing firm on God's word at every opportunity he receives, as we've seen lately, even in his weakness, he is having to rely on God. He's given this weakness. Relying on God is what he chooses to do. Be overwhelmed by his grace. Do you live as though God's grace is enough in your life? Or do you find yourself living as though there are other things that will get you where you need to go in life? God's grace is enough. But it continues on there in verse 9, and we see the second thing this morning. Be confident in his power. It says there in verse 9, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. I would submit to you that for the believer, every moment of weakness that we have, every challenge, every stronghold we have, every trial we face is a reminder that God's grace is what we really need. That even in our weakness, we are made strong. And be confident in his power. When you are weak, are you reminded that the true power that you have comes from the Lord? Are you reminded in your moments of struggle that you can have confidence in the power of God? We talked about in our Sunday school class this morning with the students, as well as throughout the week, the main passage for camp this week, camp-wide, was Psalm 139. And we walked through it detailed every day in the morning, tabernacle time. And verse 13 and 14, I want to pull this morning because I think it fits perfectly with what we're talking about of God's grace. Verse 13 of Psalm 139 says this, "For you formed my inward parts, you knitted me together in my mother's womb, and I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made." And then it says, "Wonderful are your works, my soul knows it very well." The same God who's the God of your weakness is the same God who formed you in your mother's womb intricately, designing you in a very specific, unique way so that ultimately you can live in his grace. We can be confident, I use that word this morning, confident, in our God because we are totally and completely known by him. You can have confidence in who God is because he knows you already. He knew you before you took a breath. Being known by God allows us to have confidence in who he is. We can have confidence in God's grace, that His grace is never failing, His grace is never ending, but yet, as we just read there in verse 9, His grace is always going to be enough. We can have confidence in a powerful God who looks upon our weakness and makes it perfect in His own power. There's moments where we are broken and battered, but we don't have to worry about putting the pieces of that back together because our God, who has authority and is in control, is all-powerful, and even in our shortcomings, His power is made perfect. And even in our weakness, we can be made whole simply by the power of God because we're dependent upon Him. Are you confident in the God that you serve? Many of you in this room, you serve a lot, and you serve well. And sometimes I know that when you're serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, there are moments where serving feels like a lot. And it feels like it can get overwhelming. It feels like you're always going. You're always doing something. You're always having to do the next thing. But here's the thing, even in our weakness, even if we were to fail at the task of serving our God, His power is still made perfect in our weakness. He can still be glorified even in our failings. We are called to be faithful, but don't forget to be dependent on God. He is a perfect, all-powerful God who loves us, cares for us, yet we can be confident that He can do all things. In your life, what do you struggle with in doubting what God can do? Many of you, I would imagine, have been praying for very specific things for a very long time. And sometimes when you don't get the answer that you desire from God, we tend to think about whether He can actually do it or not. But even in our weakness, His power is made perfect. But we can have confidence in what He does for us because He knows us. We are totally and completely known by an all-powerful, perfect God. So this morning, in what way are you not fully trusting God's power? In what way are you not fully confident in what God can do? Be confident in your God. Continues on. Would you look at verse 9 again with me? It says, therefore, because of all of that, therefore I will boast in all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. I will boast all the more gladly. Be glad of your weakness, or in your weakness, excuse me. Be glad in your weakness. Number 3, bring us to a place of having joy in trials. We know James chapter 1 draws us to this place of recognizing to have joy in any given circumstance, which is 100% easier said than done. It's simple to read that off. It's simple to say, be glad in your weakness. It's another thing to do that. Be glad in your weakness. But it says, and I think this is interesting here, therefore, because of all that, I will boast more gladly in my weaknesses. So think about for a second, boasting about your weaknesses. If you were to take that as literally as you possibly could, are you going to go around to the other people here and tell them everything that is wrong with you? It would probably feel a little uncomfortable. You're walking around to someone else and you're sharing. First off, you're probably going to be oversharing just a little bit, right? There's some information that the other person simply just does not need to know, right? But as you share and as you boast in your weaknesses, somewhere down the line, it feels good to boast about those weaknesses. It feels good to share that. And I think this very specific verse in verse 9 can speak into a few things this morning. And I am really bad at this. So when I say what I'm about to say, I want you to recognize I am one of the worst at this. But as I read that, boasting about weaknesses, sometimes I have a hard time sharing how other people can be praying for me. Sometimes I have a hard time sharing with somebody else that I'm just not doing well. I'm just struggling. Sometimes I have a hard time being open with other people of, hey, I really could use prayer for this. And speaking into that a little bit, church, we are a family of God. I know there are prayer warriors in this room today. Prayer warriors who would love nothing more than to lift you up to the Father. I need to do a better job at being open about that, personally. But I think that verse can speak into that very clearly. Even in our weakness, be glad about it. You say, well, how does that connect? When we boast in our weaknesses, when we boast and share about these things, I think, I would argue, that there is benefit to having partners in the Lord that will pray for you and lift you up to the Father in a very, very, very specific way. How can someone else in this room pray for you? When I was younger, when somebody would ask, how can they pray for me? I was like, I don't know. I don't need no prayer. I'm good. I'm doing okay. Everything's fine. Everything's good. I don't think any of us here can say everything is going perfect. Let us pray for one another. Be glad in your weakness. Because even in your weakness, does that not display his power? Does that not display how good he is? His grace restores our brokenness, but it amplifies himself in one's life instead of amplifying the weakness. So when you're sharing your weakness with one another, when you are being prayed for and someone asks you, hey, how can I pray for you? You are not amplifying this weak spot that you have in your life. You're amplifying the power of the Most High God. Be glad in your weaknesses. Even when we are weak, we may boast of it because his power is made known through our weakness. It's easier to think about how bad we are. It's easier to think about how weak we are than it is to think about how great our God is. But that is an attack from the enemy. You are made, you are created. We talked about Psalm 139. You are made and created with a purpose designed by a perfect creator who loves you. Be glad in your weakness because you are made uniquely you in God's image. If you go back to the context of 2 Corinthians 12, Paul was, of course, being brought to this place of humility and away from boastfulness. But that boastfulness becomes not about himself but about Christ. And that boastfulness comes through God's grace for him. Boasting in our weakness draws us to a place where we are essentially required to live fully and totally dependent on God. We have limitations. We have things that we simply can't do, but God's power is displayed in our weakness. Be content. Number four, be content through struggle. And that leads us into verse number 10, which is where we'll conclude this morning. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Students, I'm going to call you out just for a minute. Okay? Mm-hmm. Y'all good with that? Some of you are like, oh no, what's he going to say? What's he going to say? Sometimes one of the big struggles that we face is when someone says something not so nice to us, our first instinct in return is either insults that are as bad or worse, or even physical violence, right? So, and the kids are chuckling, laughing because I talk about this all the time. Paul's writing and he says, for the sake of Christ, because of Christ and what he's done for us, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, calamities. For when I'm weak, then I am strong. I say I was calling the students out, but I'm really calling all of us out. When we hear that word, I am content. I am okay with. I am all right with. Insults. I'm okay with that. I don't like it. If someone talks bad about me, I don't like that. When someone talks bad about you, you don't like that. When someone talks poorly about you, you don't like that. But Paul says, I'm content with it. I'm all right with it. I would say you can infer, based on the context of the passage, that even if the insult is referring to a weakness of ours that may be true, he's content. He's content. Even though he hears all of that, he's all right with it. Because his boasting is not in himself. His boasting is in Christ. Are you content with enduring struggle, with enduring consequences of sin, with enduring your weakness, with enduring persecution? And it says calamities in the translation we're using today. Calamities. When you think of calamities, I think of just, I don't know what you guys think about, I think of complete chaos. Complete chaos of just looking upon a situation and thinking to myself, this is a disaster. This is horrible. And when you think about that, it's like, okay, not the best thing. I don't really love that. Not really excited about it. But Paul says, I'm content with it. I'm good with it. Why? Because I do not find my power in myself. I do not find these divine qualities in me. I can't save myself. It's only by the grace of God, and I trust in his power and his power alone. Paul is saying, I am okay. I am content with going through the struggle because the struggle will glorify God. I am okay with walking through whatever I'm walking through. I will walk through it not down on who I am, not boasting simply in what I can do and all the things that I do well, but rather recognizing that we are weak without our Jesus. And instead of walking through struggle in fear, in depression, we walk through it with hope. And we walk through it knowing that Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and his power is made perfect where we are weak. In your weakness, be content in the Lord. In insults, be content in the Lord. Through hardship, be content in the Lord. In persecutions, be content in the Lord. In calamities, be content in the Lord, because he is greater. He is perfect, and his power is made perfect through our weakness. Our longing in life should not be for more of this or more of that. It should be for more of Jesus. It should not be more of this or that. It should be more of God's glory. Paul says there at the beginning of verse 10, for the sake of Christ. Not himself. For the sake of Christ. If being content in the struggle draws me to recognize that it's for his glory, it's worth it. It's worth it. What's a simple truth that can lead us to a place of being content with God's grace? The truth that we don't deserve it, yet we receive it anyway. That should lead us to a place of being content with who God is. So this morning, does God's grace lead you to a place of contentment and satisfaction in Christ Jesus? Are you satisfied with what you have in Christ Jesus? In your circumstances where you're seeking to want more, you're seeking to learn more, you're seeking to do more, you're seeking to make more money, you're seeking finances, you're seeking wealth, you're seeking health. In those moments where all those plans that you have are thrown away, thrown out the window, do you still find satisfaction in Jesus? Do you still find contentment in Jesus? Or do you boast about yourself? Do you find yourself conceited? Or do you boast in the grace of God? Maybe you're here today and you've not yet come to a place where you've accepted this grace. One word that I used this morning, and I'll use it again in our Sunday school class, was purpose. Purpose. In our lives, many people struggle to find purpose. There is the ultimate purpose in Christ Jesus, to bring him glory, to bring him praise with every part of our life. The only way we're going to do that is if we first accept the free gift of salvation given to us. You might be here today and you have not yet made that decision to make Jesus the Lord of your life. Allow today to be that day. That doesn't fix the struggle. That doesn't solve the puzzle to your weakness. That doesn't mean that weakness won't pop up. That doesn't mean you won't have moments of weakness. But it does mean you have hope. And you have purpose. And you have grace for when those things take place. Make Jesus the Lord of your life today. Make him the King. Would you bow with me? Lord, we are grateful for who you are. We're grateful for your goodness. We're grateful for your mercies. And Lord, we are thankful that in our weakness, we have hope. Even when we come to the end of what we can do as people, God, you can do things beyond our wildest imagination. Would you remind us of that when we need to be reminded of that? Would you show us how to see that when we need to see that? And Lord, if there's anyone here today that does not know you, I pray that today they would make you the Lord of their life, accepting the free gift of grace that you bestow upon us. May today be the day of salvation. Lord, we're grateful for who you are and what you do, and we pray all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. I invite you to stand with me. The worship team is going to begin singing a song of response here in just a minute to remind us that worship demands response. And maybe you're here today and you are wanting to follow through in baptism. We've seen two students follow through in that today. Praise God. Maybe you need to take that step. Respond by coming down this morning and saying, I need to make that happen. I need to be obedient to what God has called me to do. Maybe you are looking for a church home and you are seeking to make Jesus known in this community. Come be a part of what's happening. Come be a part of what God is doing on this corner. And I know we already prayed this morning with our deacon prayer time, but if you still are in need of prayer, maybe the Lord is moving in your life where you are in need of more prayer. Let this be the time to do that. Respond as God is leading and sing at the top of our lungs for what Jesus has done for us. Let's worship him.
Lord, you search me, how you know me. You perceive my every thought from afar. In all my wandering, still you love me. King of glory, you pursue my anxious heart. And even when I'm not your faithful, even when I doubt your truth holds, even when I'm lost, you won't let me go. You won't let me go. When my heart is dry, your grace flows. No matter where I run, I'm not far from home. Yeah, I may be weak, but you're able. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Lord, you search me, how you know me. You perceive my every thought from afar. In all my wandering, still you love me. King of glory, you pursue my anxious heart. And even when I'm not your faithful, and even when I doubt your truth holds, even when I'm lost, you won't let me go. You won't let me go. When my heart is dry, your grace flows.
No matter where I run, I'm not far from home. Yeah, I may be weak, but you're able. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Where can I go from your spirit? And where can I hide from your face? And where can I flee from your presence? Where would I go? Where would I go? If I rise to the heavens, you're with me. If I fall to the depths of the sea, even there it's your hand that will lead me. Wherever I go, wherever I go. Where can I go from your spirit? And where can I hide from your face? And where can I flee from your presence? Where would I go? Where would I go? If I rise to the heavens, you're with me. If I fall to the depths of the sea, even there it's your hand that will lead me. Wherever I go, wherever I go. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. And even when I doubt, your truth holds. Even when I'm lost, you won't let me go. You won't let me go. When my heart is dry, your grace flows. No matter where I run, I'm not far from home. Yeah, I may be weak, but you're able. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Even when I'm not, you're faithful. Even when I'm not, you're faithful.
Right, amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. I have a few announcements for you, and then it is my joy and honor to present some decisions from this week. First and foremost, church family, we want to thank you again for worshiping alongside us today. If you're visiting with us, before you leave, if you will do us a favor, on the back of your pew, you will find some connect cards that will have an opportunity for you to fill in information. That is just so we can better connect with you. So if you would do us a favor, our staff would love to reach out to you. We'd even love to pray for you where you need prayer. Fill that out. Drop it in the offering plate on your way out today. Just take some minutes to fill that out. And then, per usual, on your way out the door today, we have the opportunity to be faithful in our giving. Let us be faithful in our tithes and our offerings. We are off to a fantastic summer with that. Let us keep that rolling. Let us keep that going as we move forward. 1 week from tomorrow, 1 week from tomorrow is Vacation Bible School. So we are gearing up for that. If you have not registered for Vacation Bible School, or your child has not been registered for Vacation Bible School yet, that registration is online at exchangeokc.org. You can go there online. Yes, you can show up the day of course, but we would love it if you pre-register. That helps us get a little bit of an idea of where we're going. Go online to exchangeokc.org and you can register there. We're going to have some friends that partner with us from Wilmot Place Baptist Church joining us for that. They partnered with us in camp this year again, and it was amazing to work with them. So we're going to have some friends from there for this round of VBS as well. Kathy is going to be your go-to for that, whether you are whether you have any questions about VBS or you want to sign up to help or assist in a specific way for Vacation Bible School. 1 week from tomorrow, 6 p.m. to 8:30 every single night next week. So that is the 24th through the 28th. We'll have a family night on Friday evening. We'll have a couple inflatables out, and we'll invite the kids' family to come out as well to join us for that night. Tomorrow is our food pantry. So 3:30 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. tomorrow is our monthly food pantry. First Baptist Church of Corinth, Texas has done us a gigantic favor / blessing. In that we don't have to pack any bags this month. So the food pantry bags are already completely filled and ready to go for tomorrow. So that's at 3:30. If you are planning to help or serve at the food pantry, we ask that you can get there hopefully about 15 minutes ahead of time. That way we can kind of go over some areas that we're in need, where we need you to serve, and some more specifics about what is needed for you as you serve tomorrow. So that's tomorrow at 3:30. We are going to continue our Wednesday night meal. As we continue through our Wednesday night meal during the summer, we need more help. Simply put, we need more help with setup, the actual cooking, and especially cleanup. Cleanup is an area that we are lacking a little bit right now. So we are in big need of cleanup. So if you are available just to help simply with cleaning up on Wednesday nights, maybe stay a little bit back this next Wednesday and help us out and get the area cleaned and picked up, as those who serve the food every week, we don't want them to also have to clean every week. And we don't want them to also have to do every single thing every week. So we want them to have help. Let us step up and serve and help in that way. And then we want you to be a part of our Wednesday nights, and we want you to be a part of Sunday school. If you're looking for a way to plug into our church, make those ways important to you. Make an effort to be here Sunday mornings at 9:30 in your Sunday school class. And then Wednesday nights are a lot of fun as well at 6 p.m. So as far as announcements go, that's all I have today. You can pick up the Exchange Weekly on your way out, and you can find all the information you need in that. But I like to invite some of our students to come on back up here. We're going to form just a little line right next to me here, and I want to share a little bit about what God did this week at camp. You see a handful of students here who are joining us, and I'm going to go down the line, starting with my good old pal right here, Annalise. You guys know Annalise. She's been a part of our church for a very long time, and she's here this morning simply to come before the church and say, I need to turn back to Jesus, and I am making it a point to recommit my life to him. I know that's a term that we use. It's a man-made term that we use, but it's a term that marks that there is a active decision made in turning one's life back to Jesus. And that's what Annalise has come here this morning to do and share with you, church family. And as you saw Anessa earlier today, we're just going to make it public again. Anessa made the decision to follow Christ earlier this week. And that was Thursday evening at camp. And she's pumped about it. And as you saw, she was so pumped about it, she wanted to get baptized now. Like, let's do it. Let's get that done. And so we got to do that today, but she's up here. I want you, church family, to come congratulate her on that decision, and just let her know that we're going to walk alongside her in that way. And then over here, my buddy, old pal, Gary. Many of you guys know Gary. Gary means a lot to us, and this week, Gary came up to me. I just want to be clear about this. Gary came up to me on Thursday evening, and he just told me, basically, I'm going to sum it up a little bit, but Gary told me basically, I just need to turn back to the Lord. Satan's been trying to steal my identity in Christ, and I don't want that anymore. And he made that decision Thursday night, and I couldn't be more prouder of him. And then as we'll call Chef Curry down here on the end, Eric Curry down there, man, Eric almost didn't go to camp. And throughout the week, I could see throughout the week how the Lord was working in Eric. And similar to Gary, Eric came up to me, and he said, "I need to make a change, right? I need to make a change. I've been living one way. It's time for me to live a different way. I know Christ, but it's time for me to change how I've been living." And so Eric made that decision this week to recommit as well. So by rejoicing in this, let me know that you're rejoicing with them by saying amen this morning.
Amen.
And man, yeah. The Lord is moving in a fantastic way. And on your way out today, you guys hang out for just a minute right where you are. Church family, just come encourage them on your way out the door today. Support them. Let them know that they're going to have people they can walk alongside in following Jesus. So let's pray, and then you'll be dismissed for the day. Would you pray with me? Lord, we're so grateful for all that you're doing. And we're grateful for how you moved this week at camp. And it is an honor to present these decisions today. We're grateful for how you've moved, and we pray that as we go, we would live in your grace, recognizing that we can be content. We can have hope in you, not our own being, not our own weaknesses, but hope in you and you alone. We love you, Lord. May we live a life pleasing to you as we go. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon, everybody. Hang out here for a minute. Hang out up here for a minute.
Lost. My salvation. his sacred hand. See